Good morning.
All right, you guys are as late as I am. So it's weird that I'm going to be talking about the teams when the teams aren't here, but I'm still going to talk about them. So they left Wednesday for NYC. They come back next Wednesday from NYC right now. I think they're getting ready to go from Tampa to Orlando to go have some fun. They've been doing worship services. I asked them to send me some pictures. I got pictures of palm trees, some buildings, a bunch of other people other than them. I was like, can I get some with you in them, please? I got one. So hopefully next Sunday I will get more pictures, and we're going to talk to the teams next Sunday and kind of do a little bit of a debrief so that you guys know what all they were doing. On the Kansas City District, am I right on that? If you guys can watch the services that they had, I know that Virginia has them on her Facebook as well. That's where I've been clicking on and watching them. They have had an amazing time. I asked Spencer how they were doing, and he said that they really were enjoying the sermons and seemed to be getting a lot out of them. So we're still praying for our teams on the trip. I will say the very first night they had a yacht party, so while it was really hot here, they were having fun. The next thing I want to announce is the fifth Sunday of this month is going to be Youth Sunday. So the youth are doing everything from start to finish on the service. They're going to be doing, they're helping with music, they're going to be doing the announcements, the prayers, we'll be doing the sermon as well, so you guys are going to want to come for that. Now I know what you're thinking, this Sunday, hang on, isn't that usually Hymn Sunday? Well, we're going to back that up to the fourth Sunday so that you guys still get that. And then don't forget to get your hymns, your favorite hymns to Dad, or Richard, so that he has a list of ones that you want. Obviously, we can't get to every one of them, but sometimes we can do melodies and stuff. We can do the ones where we put all the songs together. Medley. You know, that's the word I was looking for. So be praying for that as well, for the teams, and then also for the Hymn Sunday. So let's pray together. Dear Lord, we come before you today and ask you to bless us in our worship. We pray that you would fill us with your Holy Spirit and help us worship you. Fill our hearts with joy of your salvation and help us to proclaim the good news of Jesus Christ so that all people might come to know him. Amen.
Thank you.
The golden stairs that climb, Thank you, praise team. Hey, I'm on. My friends, I think the song said it better than I could say it, and I think that the Lord ministers to us as we sing praise and worship to Him. And sometimes it just hits you that we just don't know. Time we have left. Well, it's the time we set aside in service for family prayer, and I just invite you to. Don't let it slip by you. I recently spent some time with a man who told me just about giving up on everything. I think the world is just despicable. It's all going down. And everything in it is just going bust. I said, is Augie despicable? My baby boy? Kind of shifted his perspective. Not quiet. My wife? Despicable? You wake up a baby child in a crib sometimes, and it really just hits you. I don't know, I was in a hotel the past few days, so maybe it hit me differently this morning. We don't know what day will be our last, but we understand unless Jesus comes for us first, that we're all facing death, a death sentence, really. That's the truth. We have an eternal hope in Jesus Christ, our only hope, the source of abundant life today and eternal life now and forever. Amen. So I just invite you to reflect upon these things during this time. Please join me in prayer. Take it to the Lord. Jesus, we understand today that amongst us that there are many heavy hearts. And Lord Jesus, just ask and pray for your special healing touch and your healing comfort on people who have walked through so many trials and tribulations, and some that are facing brand new ones, and they don't know what tomorrow holds. But Lord, you do. And you have us here today, now, for a reason. We're going to praise you because of that. So Lord, we ask that you would touch and save and rescue, provide hope to every hurting heart. And Lord God, we just give it to you. We place it in your hands. We ask not my will be done, but your will be done, trusting that even if we are not delivered today, but rather we are placed in the lion's den or the fiery furnace, that you are still God, and that you will raise us and give us new heavenly bodies, eternal life forever. Because we have this hope right now in our jars of clay, in our broken vessels, that shines through the darkness because of your great light, your love, your grace, and your mercy. The ability for us to see beauty in the world, in a child, in a parent, in a friend. And we thank you, Jesus, that you have opened our eyes to the Holy Spirit to see you. We ask and pray that the eyes of anyone who has not seen you or needs help, saying, I believe, help my unbelief, that you would just increase our faith today, their faith today. Because you're an awesome God. Your goodness is chasing us down. If we might just turn and not harden our heart to your call, but humble ourselves, repent, and receive the awesome life you have for us today. Thank you, Jesus. It's in your awesome, precious, and saving name we pray. We actually have a special announcement that we're going to do today, along the kind of lines I've been talking about. So I'd like to invite Mary up at this time. She's going to share with you just a little bit. I'll give Mary a microphone while she's coming.
Shelp family for Pastor Shelp. I don't think I can read it. I am weeping now, and the fragility of my life has become very real to me in the past month. And I don't know what tomorrow brings. And hopefully one day I'll turn it into one of these. Pastor Shelp was very dear to our church back in the 80s. He served 8 years, I believe. Through an interesting time of life in the church. And we were so thankful when he moved back to Kansas City and chose for his church to come back to his church. Treasured that time we had with him. And the most beautiful thing to me this morning, we wanted to present it to Mark, his youngest son. And Mark chose to go to his own service because his service means so much to him. He lives life service and is very attached to his church that he's been going to for several years. So on his 40th anniversary, which is today, after their service, he and Ramona are coming to the church where they got married 40 years ago, right here, and they're going to accept the certificate and come to church and pray and just visit by themselves, nobody else.
gift to die is to see with clear vision all mysteries revealed, and away is swept the curtain from joys which are now concealed. If to die is to greet all the martyrs and prophets and sages of old, and to joyously meet by still waters the flock of our own little fold, if to die is to join in hosannas to a risen, reigning Lord, and to feast with him at his table on the bread and wine of his board, if to die is to enter a city and be hailed as a child of its king, O grave, where soundeth thy triumph? O death, where hideth thy sting? The certificate is presented in memory of Reverend Donald Shelp, whose name has been placed on the memorial roll of Nazarene Missions International. He will also be honored at the Kansas City District Church of Nazarene District Assembly. Amen. I'd like to say a thank you to Mary and Crystal and our NMI, who have been faithful also for quite a long time, and for presenting this role. I also just want to mention that Pastor Self and I spent a lot of time together, and really touched my heart. And for those of you who don't know, as Mary said, he had ministered here in the past in the 80s and continued to attend. And this is what we do in the church in Nazarene. We're a family, the family of God, and we honor each other with memorial roll when we pass, the Lord takes us home. And so that's what this has been about. And I will never, ever forget Pastor Felt and the impact he had on me personally as well. He continued to be a pastor here in that sense, very much so. Amen. Well, my friends, you never know what the Lord might be up to. It's a time in the service where we turn to worship through the Word at this time. Coming into it feels a little bit different now. Well, I invite you to participate in worship through the Word at this time, continuing our July summer series with us together. Give it to God. Gift to God is what we've already been doing and singing and praying this morning. But nevertheless, it's a phrase that we hear. It can mean different things to different people at different times. You know, we might be holding on to areas of sin in our lives that we haven't committed to Jesus. You know, things we refuse to repent of and give over to God. God might also be, well, experiencing some grief or suffering or loss. Many of us are. And simply needing to give that to God. Not to pretend like hurt never happened or to wave a magic wand, but rather to receive His ongoing, compassionate comfort and new mercies. Give to God. Last week we laid the foundation for the series. So today we're going to return to the scripture once again and just build up from there. It doesn't matter if you missed it. You jump on in with it. And the scripture for today is, well, it's the story of Daniel and the lion's den. That's found in the book of Daniel, Daniel and the lion's den. And we're just going to be looking at chapter 6, verses 1 through 23. And it's a familiar story to most, a children's church story, you might say, perhaps. But you know, while many are familiar with this narrative, not everyone is so familiar with the bigger picture, the bigger context, and all that the Spirit of God might have to say and do in our hearts through His Word in that kind of way, in the fullness of the Scripture. So this is a longer passage. I invite you to turn in your Bibles there. Of course, we'll have it on screen for you. It's a longer passage. We'll need some unpacking, so just stick with it. Daniel chapter 6, verses 1 says, "It pleased Darius to appoint 120 satraps to rule throughout the kingdom, with three administrators over them, one of whom was Daniel. The satraps were made accountable to them so that the king might not suffer loss. Now, Daniel so distinguished himself among the administrators and the satraps by his exceptional qualities that the king planned to set him over the whole kingdom. At this, the administrators and satraps tried to find grounds for charges against Daniel in his conduct of government affairs, but they were unable to do so. They could find no corruption in him because he was trustworthy and neither corrupt nor negligent. Finally, these men said, 'We will never find any basis for charges against this man, Daniel, unless it has something to do with the law of his God.' So, these administrators and satraps went as a group to the king and said, 'May King Darius live forever. The royal administrators, prefects, satraps, advisors, and governors have all agreed that the king should issue an edict and enforce the decree that anyone who prays to any god or human being during the next 30 days, except to you, Your Majesty, shall be thrown into the lion's den.' Now, Your Majesty, issue the decree and put it in writing so that it cannot be altered, in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed." So King Darius put the decree in writing. Now, when Daniel learned that the decree had been published, he went home to his upstairs room where the windows opened toward Jerusalem. Three times a day, he got down on his knees and prayed, giving thanks to his God, just as he had done before. Then, his men went as a group and found Daniel praying and asking God for help. They went to the king and spoke to him about his royal decree. "Did you not publish a decree that during the next 30 days, anyone who prays to any god or human being except to you, Your Majesty, would be thrown into the lion's den?" The king answered, "The decree stands in accordance with the law of the Medes and Persians, which cannot be repealed." Then they said to the king, "Daniel, who is one of the exiles from Judah, pays no attention to you, Your Majesty, or to the decree you put in writing. He still prays three times a day." When the king heard this, he was greatly distressed. He was determined to rescue Daniel and made every effort until sundown to save him. And the men went as a group to King Darius and said to him, "Remember, that according to the law of the Medes and Persians, no decree or edict the king issues can be changed." So the king gave the order, and they brought Daniel and threw him into the lion's den. The king said to Daniel, "May your God, whom you serve continually, rescue you." A stone was brought and placed over the mouth of the den, and the king sealed it with his own signet ring and with the rings of his nobles, so that Daniel's situation might not be changed. The king returned to his palace and spent the night without eating and without any entertainment being brought to him. He could not sleep. At the first light of dawn, the king got up and hurried to the lion's den. He came near the den. He called out to Daniel in an anguished voice, "Daniel, servant of the living God, as your God, whom you serve continually, been able to rescue you from the lion?" Daniel answered, "May the king live forever. My God sent his angel, and he shut the mouth of the lions. They have not hurt me, because I was found innocent in his sight. Nor have I ever done any wrong before you, Your Majesty." The king was overjoyed gave orders to lift Daniel out of the den. And when Daniel was lifted from the den, no wound was found on him because he had trusted in his God. The word of the Lord. Father God, we thank you for your word. We thank you, Holy Spirit, that you are on the move through your word. God, we just ask and pray that in this service, in this time, in this place, in this moment, we would be open to what it is that you are speaking to us. And even though we come from all different walks of life, you have something for us today. We believe that. So Lord, may we open our ears, our eyes, our hearts for the spiritual truth that you would have for us. Thank you, Jesus. In your name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, through the rise and the fall of various empires all throughout history, and there have been many, Daniel's well aware of that. No matter the empire, all the kingdoms of all the world, they all share something in common. Lord Acton, who was an historian in the late 1800s, said it well with a quote you may be familiar with. He penned it in a personal letter. Power tends to corrupt, and absolute power corrupts absolutely. And like Daniel's time, we know even today there is much corruption to go around in government and other spheres. I was interested, so I Googled it. I found a study of the U.S. Congress, finding that among the members of Congress, there were many convictions of fraud. There were several arrests for writing bad checks, members of Congress. There were drug charges, shoplifting charges, arrests, dozens of arrests for spousal abuse. Many lawsuits against Congress members. That was not so surprising. And there were many DUIs. It's government corruption, and it probably doesn't surprise any of you. With this in mind, what is remarkable here is when King Darius made it known in this government that he was going to place Daniel over the whole kingdom, all the king's horses and all the king's men, the satraps, administrators, they try to find charges against Daniel and his conduct, but they're unable to do so. No corruption. Daniel was so distinguished because there was no corruption found in him. Daniel placed God first in all things, and he was a man of faith. Just setting the stage for this, I'd like to pause here and just get a little bit more context. Speaking of the empires. Well, here in the book of Daniel, we're at a point in history when the Persian Empire reigned supreme. We heard about the Persians and the Medes. Well, previously in Daniel, the book, we encounter King Nebuchadnezzar of the Babylonians, another huge empire in history. But the Babylonians are no longer in power. So we know Daniel lived at a time of the rise and the fall of these empires. A lot of turmoil. But no matter the turmoil, no matter the times we live in, our times today, you know, the kingdoms of this world all have that same thing in common. Unjust laws, corruption, wickedness, it's there. So that's where we are in Bible history, where Daniel was. By the way, the word satrap, interesting word, not one you hear every day. Satrap comes from an old Persian word for a protector of the empire. It reflects this period in history. This happened around 539 BC. So, at this point, Daniel is one of three administrators, verses 1 and 2. He's an older man by now. Daniel distinguished himself such that the king planned to place him as number two, other than himself, King Darius, over the kingdom and over these satraps, these high-up protectors. And so, you know, you can almost feel the jealousy exuded in this passage. It's all political, you understand. So they hatched this plot to bring Daniel down. And the jealous officials, they go and they pitch this plot to the king. Well, these men knew Daniel was faithful to God. The only way to discredit him was to force the king to issue this decree opposed to the laws of God. Well, notice here, just pause for a moment. Notice here, the plot is corrupt to begin with, right? Verse 7. These people are just lying to the king. You know, these days, it is often this way for us, believers in Jesus Christ. When we are trusting Jesus, we are simply being faithful. Sometimes deceit is used to turn others against us. I imagine it has already happened to you, or it will. Because the darkness takes the light. So this is the plot. This is the story. Anyone who prays to anyone, anything, beside the king, shall be thrown in the lion's den. Okay, wow. And pausing for a moment on this decree, hey, isn't it remarkable that this is about prayer? That there is a premium placed on prayer. It's a prayer law. Because as I prepared this message, I began to think a little bit about the more or less lame excuses that often keep us from a faithful and consistent prayer life. And the Lord will convict you of that if you read Daniel chapter 6. Right? I have to get the chores done. I need more sleep. I'm too busy. I have a pertinent reminder on screen. It says, if you are too busy to pray, then you are too busy. Daniel might agree with this one. They had better be good excuses when we don't pray. Because one day, at the final judgment, we might be standing next to Daniel. And let's look at his prayer. Well, verse 10, Daniel learned about the decree. Hey, check this guy out. He apparently heard about the decree and headed for the most prominent and visible location in his home. He opened the windows for everybody to see. He got down on his knees and he prayed. Obviously, for Daniel, nothing, absolutely nothing, was going to keep him from praying. Not even a death sentence attached to a non-repealable decree. And by the way, we know from history these non-repealable decrees existed. Yeah, we know from the Bible, we verified it through historical research and archaeology. Furthermore, they were cruel and unusual punishments. Thrown into a lion's den, this is very real. Cruel and unusual punishment. Behind me, behind the screen, is the cross, the Roman cross. The instrument of torture of death used by the Roman Empire after Daniel's time that Jesus faced. Capital punishment. The law of the land. Daniel deliberately defied a law of the land. I think this is something that we miss when we read this. It's this aspect of it, that how do we reconcile this man of faith, Daniel, with the Bible's overall teaching, and we see it in Daniel as well, to obey the law, to obey civil authority. It's a timely topic. We spoke about it last week as well, on the 4th of July. Because you know what? God's Word has the answers we need. So, in the Bible, I just want to show on screen for you, we read this. Let everyone be subject to the governing authorities, for there is no authority except that which God has established. The authorities that exist have been established by God. Consequently, whoever rebels against the authority is rebelling against what God has instituted, and those who do so will bring judgment on themselves. Okay. And however many times that I hear this scripture, there is something so incredible about it that it just hits me every time. It's amazing. You know, the Apostle Paul, inspired of God, is writing this letter, writing these things to the church in Rome. That's why we call it Romans. Rome is the center for persecution and the killing of Christians. By who? The authorities. And yet, the Apostle Paul is penning these things, inspired of God. So why would the Scripture say this? Why would the Bible have this? The whole book of Daniel, at large, in fact, is about how the kingdoms and the laws of this world are evil, but that the kingdom of God is above them all and will, in fact, replace them all. And this is much of what Jesus speaks about as well in the Gospels. So, two observations this morning. Observation number one, Daniel submits. In fact, he is an essential part of this evil kingdom in his day. I'm not calling Daniel evil. Well, why is this the case? Well, he's there because God has put him there, called him there. And God put him there for a reason, to show forth God's faithfulness, God's love, God's glory. God has him there to enact legislation with God's morality, to uphold God's holiness, to live holy today, to demonstrate God's love. It's amazing. This helps us understand the Roman scripture. And I hope you know today it's the same with us. Yeah, sure it is. God has placed you all in places, government employee or not, traditional workplace or not. God has you here and there for a reason. God's reasons. We're meant to represent God as His image bearers in the world today. Represent God and testify to the faithfulness of Jesus, His saving work. Okay. Observation number two. Well, Daniel in the Bible teaches there is a higher law. There is a higher law than the law of the land. Peter and the other apostles told the authorities of their day, we must obey God rather than men. And they had been with Jesus. Hey, you know, recently I've been learning more about Corey Ten Boom. Are we familiar with Corey Ten Boom? I actually just heard that the film The Hiding Place is going to receive a remake. It's going to be redone. So Corey Ten Boom was a Christian who worked with her family to help many Jewish people escape the Nazis during the Holocaust by hiding them in her home. So the work is called The Hiding Place. It's a hiding place in the home that they utilized. Well, Corey Ten Boom broke the law when she hid Jews from the Nazis. However, she would have broken God's law, a higher law, had she not tried to prevent the murder of innocents. There's a higher law. There's a higher kingdom, the kingdom of God. Well, these days, we don't face the same extremes as Daniel and Corrie Ten Boom. But you know what? Today, more and more, I know we are being called to make difficult ethical choices. We are. And as our culture becomes more and more, well, just sinful, let's call it that. You know what? We increasingly find that as believers, we hold beliefs that are unpopular. We hold positions, that might violate a law of the land, even. And yet, you know what? We will continue to hold them, not because we're trying to make a show or demand our way or assert ourselves, but like Daniel, from simple faith and trust and dependence on God. Today, a simple faith in Jesus Christ. Back to the passage. Well, Daniel's enemies find him out. We know that. He's headed for the lion's den, death sentence. This was their goal all along. I have heaviness in my heart today, this morning. It's one of the negatives about switching the contacts as you begin to get teary-eyed. Can't see. Yeah, we know that death is coming for us. As believers in Christ, but we also profess that death is the last already defeated enemy that Jesus won the war against when he was raised again from death forever. Amen. This is the gospel of Jesus Christ, our eternal hope and glory. You know, but beyond the fact that we know that we will die someday, unless the Lord comes back first. You know, in life, sometimes we or our loved ones receive a death sentence. It may not be the lion's den, but maybe you or someone you are close to has received a diagnosis that does not look good. There's a scripture that comes from 2 Corinthians that I'd like to share with you about this. It's the Apostle Paul explaining all the troubles he experienced. 2 Corinthians 1, 9 through 11, he talks about a death sentence. The Bible says, "Indeed, we felt we had received the sentence of death. But this happened that we might not rely on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. He has delivered us from such a deadly peril, and he'll deliver us again. On him we've set our hope that he will continue to deliver us as he helps us by your prayers." Remember Daniel, the man of prayer. "Then many will give thanks on our behalf for the gracious favor granted us. Answer to the prayers of many." Here the Bible very much speaks into God working through prayer in the face of a death sentence. And there's life. There's life. The prayers are so critical. Everybody who prayed for Paul, they were practically facing death in those days. They saw their faith strengthened when God answered prayers. That's what Paul is talking about there. And while it is true that miraculous deliveries do build faith, and it does increase our strength and builds up our hope, well, it is also true that God does not always choose to deliver us from everything. He doesn't. Paul is saying here, however, in verse 9, it is God who raises the dead. And this is why we have such hope. This is why we continue to place faith in the Lord of life, because ultimately Jesus will deliver us. Jesus will make everything right and wipe away every tear, and death will be no more. So, although we find ourselves facing the death sentence, yet at the same time, we have life in Jesus Christ and eternal hope. So in verse 16-20 of Daniel chapter 6, coming back to Daniel, well, here it is. We learn of how they lowered Daniel into the pit of lions for the night. Nevertheless, this is interesting. The fact the king believed it was possible Daniel could be saved indicates Daniel must have been speaking about the miracles God had performed in the past. Today we sang about the goodness of God. Undoubtedly, Daniel testified to the wonders of the past, things that God did, His goodness, like perhaps dividing the Red Sea when Israel escaped Egypt. Here it is. Here's the preaching point. We too have a model for how we should be speaking and witnessing in our workplace, in our lives, to everyone we meet. Telling of the goodness of God and His wonders, how He delivered you, how He brought you here today. Don't know everything that you have walked through, but I know it has been very tough for you, because it is very tough in the world. Even facing a death sentence, we see Daniel's faithfulness. We know he had to have been speaking about the awesome things God had done in his life. There's a bigger context of exile and such. I'm not even scratching the surface of. But I wonder, in the practical application, preaching point, I wonder how many of our bosses in our workplaces, in our lives, well, that they know we are Christians because of what we say and do. Right? They knew about Daniel. So they go to check the lion's den early in the morning. In verse 22, Daniel says, "My God sent His angel. He shut the mouths of the lions. They have not hurt me. I was found innocent in His sight, and I have not wronged you either, Your Majesty." We see the Lord answered his prayer. The premium on prayer. Once again, prayer. Prayer unleashes the power of God to do God's will. And yet, we must also have the right perspective on prayer, the Bible's perspective. Because prayer is not a coin we put into a vending machine so that by putting enough in that we get what we want from God. Gimme, 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 God. Rather, we know the relationship. We know of the goodness of God. We know of His plan that is bigger than us, bigger than ourselves. We know, in fact, that Jesus is Lord. Jesus is God. Jesus is Lord, best and finally revealed through His life and His teachings, His death, resurrection, and eternal life. So we know the Lord works out His plan, just as we see Jesus obeying everything He saw the Father doing. So that, in the end, God does bring His love, His justice to every situation, new life in the face of a death sentence. Whether that will be in this life for us or the one to come, well, only God knows. But we are confident today. We are confident today. We believe. We trust. We know that God's reasons for this are John 3:16, holiness and love and healing and hope. That though we may suffer now, God so loved the world. That's why He sent Jesus. That's why He did it all. We may not face a literal lion's den in our own lives, but whatever it is we're facing, give it to God. We can give it to God. We can fully trust Jesus for full and complete salvation, for restoration, rescue, sanctification, healing, justice, holiness, hope. It's all in Jesus. I know we may not get the result we want here in this life, in our walk. But we still know we got to make every effort to strive. Strive in perseverance and faithfulness, like Daniel. And yet we know it is the hope of glory. It is the resurrection of Jesus. He will make everything right in the end. He will even raise us to new life, new resurrection bodies, even in the new heavens and new earth, where death and suffering will be completely gone forever. And there will be no more wicked and corrupt kingdoms of this world being replaced, finally and forever, by the kingdom of God. Amen? Why don't you pray with me today? Father God, we thank you for your mighty and powerful word. We pray not our will, but yours be done. Not my kingdom come, but thy kingdom come. Lord God, we pray it come on earth as it is in heaven. Lord, I know, we know that you work in many ways, and that even now through your word, God, you may be working on someone who may have a hardness of heart. Lord God, may we be humble by praise and worship or Pastor Mike, but ultimately by you and your goodness and your faithfulness. Not that Daniel's faithfulness saved him, but that God, your faithfulness, delivered him in the end. And so we trust in Jesus. Not by our works, but by your amazing grace, your tender mercy and loving kindness, that you would save us. Not just forever from now, but right now. And we praise you for that, Jesus. And we ask and pray that anybody hearing this now would not harden their heart, but simply receive joy, the setting free, and the forgiveness, and the amazing grace that came at such a high price, the price of love. Thank you, Jesus, for what you're at work doing here amongst us today. It's in your awesome name we pray. Thank you. Amen. This is a time in our service that we set aside to close. And, well, it's for blessing. It's for His love to defend us. So I offer this closing blessing. It's not from me, ultimately. It's in the Lord. It's from a few scriptures. It says that it's for freedom that Christ has set us free. Stand firm, then, and do not let yourselves be burdened again by a yoke of slavery. So if the Son sets you free, you will be free indeed. For in Christ Jesus, the law of the Spirit of life sets you free from the law of sin and death. And amen. And as we do, we're going to sing our closing song before we go.
Sing praise to God.
Thank you.